Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Gabriel, let me ask a quick question. I've got several questions to be able to go through with other folks here, but I'm tracking through the Biden team that they have announced that they want the power sector to be 100% renewable by 2035. I would assume that's going to require some transmission lines and trying to be able to connect places that have more renewables to places that do not. Mr. Gabriel, would you make that same assumption as well, that we're going to have increased number of transmission lines to be able to hit that kind of goal by 2035?
Yeah, yes, I do. And I also believe in we're going to have to upgrade some of the existing transmission system that we have.
Well, I noticed just for what you're dealing with, we started pulling through what I love the name of this, the Transwest Express Transmission Project. I love the name Express in there, the Transwest Express Transmission Project. It looks like this project started in 2007 and still has not commenced construction yet at this point, based on permitting, studies, right-of-ways, surveys. Is that correct?
That's correct. I've only been here since 2013, and I will say in 2015, I signed the record of decision for the project to move forward. It was similar to the comment I made earlier. Someone's got to agree to the offtake in order for these lines to be built, so that there can be transmission agreements. And that's really been the hang-up thus far.
So this conversation about let's just quickly do renewable power and we'll send it all over the country and get it done begs the question of how you're going to do transmission lines for that when we've got a transmission line project that started for you in 2007 and is still not close to being complete at this point. Sometimes 2035 seems like a long way away unless you're doing capital projects and permitting and such, and it's actually not that far away nor realistic. Mr. Schellenberger, let me ask you serious questions. You had a very intriguing line of your statement where you talked about complexity and it being one of the challenges. What I heard from you basically was just because we can do that doesn't mean it's actually the right way to do it. There seems to be a lot of work on, yes, this could be done, but it makes it so incredibly complicated, drives up the cost, as you talked about before. What is it more, if you were to clean the slate, as you're looking at it with your studies, what's a clean, straightforward way to be able to provide clean energy for the United States, less complex?
Yeah, thank you, Senator. That's a great question. I think that there's a lot of folks in the sector who are good engineers, and when they're asked the question of whether they could do something, they answer truthfully and say, yes, they could, but they don't finish the sentence in the ways that you just did, which is that all of that additional complexity brings challenges to resiliency, affordability, and reliability, and that's just very well established in the literature that the more complex the system is, the more expensive it is. I interviewed the lead author of the National Academies of Sciences report. You know, they were very clear about this issue. I mean, ideally you have, and we also know that larger plants are more efficient. So what you want is a grid with the least number of power plants that you need and the least amount of associated wires and transmission and storage. Every time you put energy into storage and you take it back out, you're doing two energy conversions, and so you're paying a very significant penalty, even in pumped hydro, which is our currently most efficient form of storage. So, I think this kind of headlong pursuit into more complexity and more transmission and more storage, you just have to kind of ask, is that really in the best interests of the American people?
It's a very interesting insight on this. Mr. Robb, I want to ask a little bit about natural gas, because we've had a lot of conversation about that, what's working, not working, the details. It's interesting. I mean, if I look at the Southwest Power Pool that I happen to live in, and I had the wonderful experience of experiencing 4 hours with no power a couple of weeks ago when it was kind of chilly at night. So for all of us that looked at not only reliability but resiliency of it, natural gas has been in this conversation. When I talk to folks in natural gas, they'll say it is a unique challenge that they're getting because they're approaching a tipping point for them to say natural gas is quick to be able to turn on. But when you're not asked for much for a long period of time, and then suddenly you ask for a lot in a short period of time, especially in an extremely cold weather event, then suddenly it's like, you know what, we can't turn it all on that fast that much. Is there a tipping point that you're seeing for providing other fuels that are out there that, for instance, we're 40%, 50%, 60% renewables, and you've got a very small portfolio of natural gas, and then the wind stops blowing and it's a cloudy day and you suddenly don't have those and you ask natural gas to turn on 50% suddenly, that's just not realistic because what is upstream is not able to turn on that fast. Is that a realistic conversation?
I think that is the conversation that needs to take place. Natural gas plants are the most flexible that we have in the system to accommodate the variability that we see with large amounts of variable resources. And it is a real challenge for the natural gas industry to provide that kind of capacity that quickly. It's not designed to do that. But that's what the electric industry needs. And this is the question that I think policymakers and probably legislators are going to have to tackle, which is how do we create a construct for natural gas to be able to serve these very unique needs of the electric system for which it's not designed to do. Right. And that's going to require a fair amount of investment and some important policy.
And that'll require some storage and other things we've talked about before. Increased storage capacity for natural gas can offset some of that as well.
Exactly.
I'd love to get into a dialogue with you. I just don't have time on this. But you had some really interesting conversations about home heating oil versus natural gas in the Northeast and some of the challenges there. I'm always fascinated when I talk to my friends from New England who want to talk to me about carbon footprint when home heating oil has a 40% plus higher carbon footprint than natural gas does. In the Midwest, we use natural gas. They use home heating oil, then lecture us about carbon footprint. It's always a fascinating conversation, but love to be able to have that sometime.
We have a great dinner conversation ahead of us.
Senator Wyden.